So the title is the Eden Works, Water Infrastructure for Public Use in Coquebo. In the last year, 2015, between 24 and 26 of March, a big part of the northern area of the country in Chile suffered the biggest rainfall in 80 years. So large extents of urban and rural areas were flooded and suffered damages. This is Copiapó, one of the suburban areas of Copiapó. Here you can see there were 30,000 victims and 31 deceased by this event, and it affected specifically downtown Copiapó and the areas around the river Copiapó that goes along the entire city. Here you can see a picture of downtown Copiapó the next days after the flood. Here's the river. You can see how the streets were cut down by the water. And here another pictures. Here's some. They took several months to remove all the water and the mud from the houses. Here's a school, a rural school in the Atacama region where Copiapó is located. And the incredible thing about this rain is that Copiapó is situated on this red line, on that latitude, and it's in the beginning of one of the driest areas of the world, the Atacama Desert. So it should be it's not expected at all a rain like the one that they suffered. Here is the specific area. You can see how along Chile, even the color, the green areas start to lack. And finally you get to the north area where Copiapó is, where absolutely no vegetation is located, and Copiapó is part of the system of the Copiapó Valley. Goes through from the Andes to the Pacific Ocean, with a lot of little rural towns around along the river. It's an area dedicated mainly to agriculture and mining. Here's a mining map of the region. Sorry for the quality of the map. I just found it, but it's not very beautiful. You can see almost 40 projects going on currently, mainly copper, gold, and silver. And you can see the amounts. Here are the expected mining inversions in the next years. It's $30,000 billion. And as a comparison, you can see that the project of free higher education in Chile will cost $3.4 billion a year. So it's quite impressive, the amount that we're talking. And because of that, this region has the second place in GDP per capita of the country, even above the metropolitan area. But of course, the GDP is not equally given to all the inhabitants of the region. If you look closer, you can see here the Copiapó River Valley. You can see it's like an oasis, basically, fully dedicated to crops of grapes, to vineyards. It's almost 30,000 hectares of vineyards. And despite it looks pretty beautiful, from certain distance, you can see that this is a monoculture that is very degrading of the original landscape, and it uses all the water resources, not only the superficial but the underground resources, which has been qualified as a very good example of an unsustainable attitude through to the landscape and the water resources. So here's the city. You can see that it goes in the same direction of the river Copiapó. It's surrounded by these hill ranges on the north and south. And there are historically two areas, the central areas here close to the river, which is the consolidated historic center, and the highlands close to the hill ranges, which have been occupied by mid to low income inhabitants, and especially specifically in the hill ravines. Some informal settlements have been appearing in the last years. So this is the structure of the city. Here you can see the informal settlements. Maybe there are no big numbers yet. It's in the whole Atacama region, there are a little bit more than 1,000 families living there, and 19 slums here in the urban areas. And as I say, while it's not big numbers yet, the informal settlements have been growing in the last years, especially because of the mining activities. It attracts a lot of people that look for a job related with mining on the tertiary areas of the economy, or looking for a temporary job on the props. So it's a little fragile and unstable inhabitant. Here you can see a current aerial view of the city. And you can see here, this is a picture from 1937, how the city has changed. It was originally an oasis landscape, fully dedicated to small agricultural activities, even in the inner space of the blocks. So, and the river with water, but now the river is completely dry since 1996, in fact. Not because of the climate, which has been the same for a long time, but because of the mining and the agricultural activities that occur upstream, the activities that we already saw. So again, an old picture. I didn't have the date or the year of this picture, but you can see how was the river and the landscape and the ecological values that it had, and how the citizens enjoy it, except for them maybe. So the situation with the water has changed a lot in the recent years, and that's in a large extent because of our water code, Water Act, that is from 1981. And in that code, water was defined as a commodity that can be traded in the market. So it has produced an huge interest over these water rights, and probably the precise prices that are paid for those water rights, or that mining products or agricultural products pay for that water right, are not known, but they are probably amongst the highest in the world, especially in this area. Here you can see an official decree that defines Copiapó as a water scarcity area. This is from 2015, but this kind of decree has already appeared 2008, 2012, 2013, and the last year. So it's a condition that is a little bit like a repetitive condition. And furthermore, now we know that the quality of water is below the Chilean standards for human consumption. So it's clearly an emergency, as important, or I can say maybe more important than the other emergency of the flood. But obviously you can see how the flood was covered by the media around the world, obviously with much more coverage. But probably these kind of things affect the inhabitants and the ecological system much more strongly than these kind of things. Anyway, just to see a little bit more how was the flood, here are the 3 days where the flood was concentrated. Again, we can see Copiapó in that latitude, in the red line. It was not, again, not that much. It was only 56 millimeters in 3 days. But, I don't know, London has 600, and this specific city has only less than 20 millimeters in a whole year. So in 3 days, they have almost three times. Here are the an official plan of the city where the flooded areas in red, and you can see that the, not all the city, but a large extent of it was flooded. Incredibly, the poorest areas in the high highlands were untouched by the flood, but the specific water path changes in every rain, event. So you have to be prepared for different stages. The last flood in 1997, it did affect the highlands where the informal settlements are located. So here are some figures that are pretty impressive again. Here you can see the fundings considered for the development of public works in the Atacama region until for 10 years. It's $1,500 million dollars versus the reconstruction plan for Atacama that was developed after the floodings, and it increases in 180 times this budget. And for Copiapó, it increases in 267 times. So again, it's pretty impressive how a little bit of planning or, I don't know, water management planning could have saved us as a country. So the crisis can be resumed in this image. So you have obviously a city that is fully defined by its relationship with water, either by scarcity or by excess. So then in a visit that I made a few months after the floodings, I visited some of the water infrastructure in the city, and they are usually on the hills, surrounded by informal settlements like these water tanks, and you can see how they are highly protected because it's a highly valuable commodity. But anyway, people in these informal settlements managed to get the water anyway from these tanks. You can see here another water tanks in the city and how they are highly protected. These are another kind of water infrastructure. These are retention basins. They are 14 retention basins located in the ravines around the city. And in this case, they didn't work at all, but they are absolutely necessary if you want to be prepared for different water paths in different stages. And again, they are surrounded by these emerging informal settlements. It's interesting because this is another water infrastructure and how it relates with the lowest part of the city. It's interesting because these places showed me some very valuable landscape and sightseeing values. You can see how some people begin to use this space as a training spot, like this girl and this lady. And it has appeared some flora and some ecological values too in these ravines. So I did this mapping later, showing how the water infrastructure, the water tanks, the retention basins are always around the informal settlement, and how they start to show some pattern or some line that start made me think that these two realities, these two realms, the informal development of the city and the water and the water infrastructure, is already related, but it can be further developed in a more constructive kind of relationship. The idea of infrastructure, so it's pretty well depicted in these two images from the Haussmann reconstruction or development in Paris. You can see how under the street surface, the city the city life occurs without knowing what happens underground, and these are in a way two equivalent worlds, but they coexist without talking to each other in a way. So this kind of highly technified infrastructure was developed in the middle of the 19th century, and here's well depicted by Ruby and Foguet, two Spanish architects. And they show in this image how, in a way, the public affairs, the politics, and the human activities, as well as the domesticated nature, lives above the surface, and below you have these highly technological inhabitants or artifacts without the knowledge of the citizens. And they propose that this infrastructure can be reclaimed again as a political affair. Then I have read some other ideas that surround the infrastructure literature. Sustainability is very important in the latest literature about infrastructure, and it's very interesting the idea of choice, of the ability that if you develop a sustainable infrastructure, you are giving a wide range of choices to a community. Or if you said it another way, you can say that you can provide you can provide or meet the needs of the current generation without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So the idea of community, the idea of choice, and the idea of development are quite related. Grid infrastructure too, it's an idea that comes when you see Copiapó, and the idea that this green infrastructure can be too, they can be environmental areas that anyway give some ecosystem services, or that can be used for human activities or by human inhabitants. And this is a very important idea. It's pretty much repeated on the literature, on the recent literature, the resilience approach. In which, especially in the planning literature, in this approach, it's accepted all the future uncertainties without being reduced to allow some predictions. So this idea talks about the necessity of explore these uncertainties and prove them in order to test the performance of this new infrastructure. Another idea that enriches the original idea that infrastructure only supports and facilitates human activity. This author, Maybum, talks that infrastructure could be empowering, so it can empower its receiver by endowing it with an added value, and the idea that infrastructure could be transformative too. Again, it not only supports, but it transforms and empowers a community or a receiver of the fluxes that goes through these networks. But you can see that generally transportation infrastructure or networks are mentioned as the main infrastructure, the one that has the real ability to transform, to guide the growing of the cities or the capacity to organize a territory, but much less is talked about water. But in the case of Copepo, it was very clear that I had to research a little bit more about water infrastructure. It's a very important thing. Drawing works may represent the biggest public investment to date in a relatively small town like Copiapó. However, given the scarce occurrence of significant rainfalls, they will remain ill, 99% of the time, with the consequent risk of being degraded or misused. So you have a problem there, or an opportunity. So you can divide infrastructure basically in two categories, in a much simplistic way. One of the facilities or the individual elements or objects that you put on a territory. This is a classic example, a windmill in Netherlands, which is originally only an engineering structure, but it has the capacity to transform a landscape or to become a symbol for even for a country. Here is an example from Medellin. These are another project that has been developed. They are called UVA, Unidad de Vía Articulada, or Articulated Life Unit. So in this case, some water tanks in the hillside are reclaimed as public space. So you can see the original situation of the public tank, or the water tank, and the project, and finally how it's been used now by the community. But much more important is the second category of infrastructure, which is the network infrastructure, and the capacity that it has to organize a territory. Here is a plan for Rotterdam for the year 2030, in which the dike system is developed or is used as a transportation system for bikes and for pedestrians. Here again, Medellin, one of the entries for the Parque del Río Medellin, considers the ecological values and the hydrology system as entry points for its project. You can see some of the images here. But in all the previous examples, you can see how infrastructure, in a way, comes after the urbanization, or infrastructure is thought as a way of improve a territory or improve some ecological values. But again, it's not that common to see examples of how infrastructure could come first or before the housing or before the rest of the urbanization. Maybe you can see some historic samples. Here are two maps from Santiago de Chile, the capital. The first one on the left is from the beginning of the 20th century. You can see the network of irrigation canals and how in a current aerial view you can see how this original irrigation canal network becomes over time in the network of roads and highways of the city. So in a way, this previous infrastructure foresaw or anticipated the development of the city. And here's a more modern and contemporary example of these ideas. Here's from David Governor, an architect from Venezuela, who developed this idea of urban armatures, in which a network of green lines or green spaces are developed or are designed before the urban process starts. And he's pretty flexible with the kind of urbanization that this system accepts. It could be informal, formal, state-funded, or inhabitants self-funded. It's not that important how you fill these spaces or these gaps, as long as you respect this green network. So, yes, those are the examples that I use.
Thank you.